Good morning, everybody. I think this is the official time to start, 5 minutes late. And I just want to make sure that everybody can hear me.
Yes.
Good, thank you. I am Barbara Sullivan. I am the Executive Director of Cambridge at Home. I would love to know how many of our members are here just by raising their hands. Wow, this is great. Wonderful. Just for those of you who don't know what Cambridge at Home is, we are an aging-in-place nonprofit 501c3. We've been in existence for 10 years. We are based in Cambridge, but we are serving people from 5 communities: Arlington, Belmont, Cambridge, Somerville, and Watertown. So if anybody wants to find out more about what we do, there's a brochure outside and I have my business card. Basically, what we do is we provide practical services, social programs, cultural adventures, a lot of health and wellness programs for people who are over 50. The major theme of Cambridge at Home is to help people who want to stay in their homes and their apartments as long as they can. Some people are just very negative about moving to a residence, an assisted living, or continuing care retirement community. And what we do is we try to provide as many resources as possible to help people feel safe, comfortable, and connected by being part of our organization. So this is the second program of a 3-part series that we are collaborating with Tufts University,
Human Nutrition Research Center.
Okay, I had it this morning, but it flew out of my mind. So this is a 3-part collaboration as well as a 3-part program. The Cambridge Public Library has really stepped up and they're welcoming us to their space, and they have helped us promote the series, and I'm sure that many of you heard about it through the library, Tufts University, and Cambridge at Home. So this is the session on nutrition and bone health, and the final of the 3 will be on Thursday, same time, 11 a.m., November 13th. And that talk is going to be about nutrition and brain health. So anybody who wants to come can either hear or respond to our email. Now I'm going to introduce Peggy Connolly, who is my cohort and collaborator, to introduce our speaker, Dr. Shea. And you can make that step, that's pretty good. Oh, wonderful. We're going to have questions and answers via microphone at the end of the presentation. There are restrooms at the end of this hall, turn left, and there's actually a water fountain. Please turn off your cell phone so we're not distracted, and we're about to start. Thank you.
Thank you, Barbara, and thank you everyone for coming today. I'm Peggy Connolly from Tufts, and it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today. First, I just want to tell you a little about the Human Nutrition Research Center on Aging at Tufts. We are an organization that has about 200 people working on science related to healthy and active aging. This partnership with Cambridge at Home and the Cambridge Public Library is really important to us because you share our passion and our mission to live independently and live a healthy life as long as you can. And so we consider you now partners with us. I hope you've taken some of our information. We also do human research studies and welcome anyone who wants to volunteer to be a part of a scientific study. They're interesting on an individual level. They certainly contribute a lot to the science, and we encourage you to look into that and join our research community as only you can. So again, thank you for coming out. I'm really curious, how many people were here last month for the eye health lecture? Terrific, it's great when people want to come back. So hopefully these 3 will be the beginning of an ongoing relationship and lecture series that I'm hopeful that we will continue in the spring, yet to be decided. So we're going to cover as much as we can in terms of the your health. And so last time it was eye health, and today it's bone health. And we're going to hear from Dr. Kyla Shea, who is a scientist in our vitamin K lab. Kyla got her PhD at Tufts, which we're very proud of. She then left Boston and went to North Carolina for a few years as a postdoc fellow at Wake Forest, came back with new insights and more knowledge, and now she is going to stay at Tufts forevermore and continue her work. Today she's going to really look at vitamin D and C, but I also urge you during Q&A, feel free to ask her about vitamin K, because she is one of the world's experts on vitamin K. It's not a large community of vitamin K researchers, but it's a very important vitamin. And we are very proud that we have the only lab in the country that focuses on vitamin K. So feel free to add those to the questions that come after. So now I'd like to ask Dr. Shea to come to the stage and inform us about our program.
Today we are one of the largest research centers in the world studying nutrition and physical activity with respect to healthy aging. We have 16 research labs or so that study different aspects of the role of nutrition in our physical activity. You heard about eye health last month. Today we're going to focus on skeletal, part of the musculoskeletal, and next month, I guess you'll hear about cognition. So this is just a brief overview of what I'm going to talk about for the next 30 minutes. I'm going to talk about what is controversial about calcium. Then we'll talk about osteoporosis and what happens to your bones when you get osteoporosis, and how you can slow the or reduce the risk of osteoporosis through calcium and vitamin D. So how many people have either seen a headline like this or something similar, or heard something similar in the news over the past, I guess maybe 5 years or so? Yeah, so what happened was, one day you're probably thinking, oh, I'm taking my calcium supplements because it's gonna help my bones, and the next time you see your doctor is saying, whoa, don't do that because your calcium supplements cause heart attack. So the background of that controversy is, I think it was around 2008 or 2010, there was a study that came out of a group from New Zealand. And the study was designed to test the effect of calcium supplementation on bone loss in postmenopausal women. There was about 1,400 women in the study, half took calcium supplement, half took a placebo, 3 to 5 years. And they did find that the calcium supplement actually helped reduce bone loss over 3 to 5 years. The study was finished, and then the researchers went back into their database and they compared the number of heart attacks in the women who took the supplements to the number of heart attacks in the women who didn't. And what they found was that there were significantly more heart attacks reported in the women who took the calcium supplement. The caveat is the study was not designed to study heart attacks, so a lot of the heart attacks were not confirmed. They were based on self-report. When they went back and reanalyzed their data and only included verified or confirmed heart attacks, there was no significant difference in the number of heart attacks between the two groups. That study got a lot of press And it actually then garnered a lot of additional research. So over the past, I would say 10 years, that there have been probably at least 20 or more studies that have looked at the relationship between calcium supplementation and cardiovascular disease or heart attack. About a year ago, a paper came out that was basically the National Osteoporosis Foundation and the American Society of Preventive Cardiology partnered up, and they asked a group of researchers at Tufts to do what's called a systematic review. And what that is they collected all of the data that were available about calcium intake, calcium supplements, and cardiovascular disease. And they did a very thorough analysis, and they concluded that basically calcium, with or without vitamin D, is not related to cardiovascular disease, cerebrovascular disease, which is like stroke, or mortality in generally healthy adults. Calcium intake that does not exceed 2,000 to 2,500 milligrams per day should be considered safe, and we'll talk about this number in a few minutes from a cardiovascular standpoint. And discontinuing calcium supplements for safety reasons is not necessary and should may be harmful if you don't get enough calcium from your diet. So this came out about a year ago, and since then, the controversy seems to be waning. So what was controversial, I would say maybe 3 to 5 years ago, is less controversial now. So with that, I'm going to talk about osteoporosis and what happens to your bones when you get osteoporosis. Osteoporosis is a public health problem. These are data that came from the International Osteoporosis Foundation, and I'll have their website up on one of the slides at the end. But basically, osteoporosis causes 2 million broken bones each year worldwide. Generally, 1 in 3 women and 1 in 5 men have osteoporosis. These are worldwide estimates. And the cost burden is about $19 billion per year. Osteoporosis is a leading cause of fracture. And hip fractures especially will reduce your likelihood or ability to live independently, which is what you all want to do. So what happens to your bones when you get osteoporosis? I'm going to start with talking about what our bones look like when we're younger. So bone is a living tissue. It's constantly turning over or remodeling. And when we're younger, say in our teens, 20s, even early 30s, it's kind of what happens is it's out with the old and in with the new. So as bone gets older and worn out, it's dissolved, and then after that, new bone is formed. When we're younger, the rate of the out with the old is the same as the rate of the in with the new. So what that results in is healthy bone that is made up of a network, kind of like scaffolding, and you can see that there's not a lot of holes in that scaffolding because the rate of bone loss and the rate of bone formation are relatively the same. Unfortunately, that doesn't last. As we get older, what happens is the rate of bone loss exceeds the rate of formation, and what happens then is the scaffolding gets weaker. So you can see here, there's more holes in that than that. And when you have more holes in the scaffolding, the bone is more likely to break. So we think of osteoporosis as primarily affecting women, and it does, but it doesn't only affect women, it also affects men. The current estimates are more than half of adults over age 60 have low bone mass. Part of that is osteoporosis. I think once men and women in their 80s are basically have a similar prevalence of low bone mass, and about 10% of men in their 80s have osteoporosis. Women lose bone quicker, so it kind of affects them at a younger age, but eventually the men. So how many people here have had a bone scan or have had their bone mineral density measured? So the reason why your doctor asked you to do that or have that test is because your bone mineral density, as your bone mineral density decreases, so as there's more holes in the scaffolding, your fracture risk increases. And what happens when you have one of those scans, it measures your bone mineral density, and it compares it to the bone mineral density of a woman, a young woman in her late 20s. And it will calculate what the comparison is called a T-score. If your T-score is positive, that means you have better bone mineral density than an average young woman. If your T-score is negative, it means you have a lower bone mineral density than a young adult woman, which is more likely to happen when we're older. Most of we're gonna lose bone as we get older. But you don't want that number to go too negative. If the number is between -1 and -2.5, that's considered osteopenic. For osteopenia, it's not quite osteoporosis, but you could have osteoporosis at some point. If the number is -2.5 or lower, even more negative, then that's considered osteoporosis. Men, if you have a DEXA scan, you will also have your bone mineral density compared to a young adult woman, and the T-scores are the same. And the reason they do that is for a given bone mineral density, if an 80-year-old man and an 80-year-old woman have the same bone mineral density, they're equally as likely to have a fracture. So,
so this is a picture of a DEXA scan, and if I can get it to work, there's a video. Yeah. So basically what a bone scan, or we call it a DEXA scan. DEXA stands for dual x-ray absorptiometry, and the reason why we don't say that is because it's really hard to say. It's kind of like a fancy x-ray. You lie on a table and there's this arm that goes over you and it measures your, in this case it was a total body bone mineral density scan. The other sites that are site specific is the hip and the lower spine, because those sites are the most likely to develop fragility fractures. And fragility fractures are fractures that occur from standing height. So when we're talking about fractures related to osteoporosis, we're not talking about the same kind of fractures, for example, if you had, were in a car accident or something like that. So that's what is measured using, if you had a DEXA scan or a bone scan, that's what it's measured. So I've told you that what osteoporosis is and how we age-related bone loss is going to happen. So what can you do? It's not something that's preventable per se, but there are things that you can do to reduce the rate of loss. And that's where calcium and vitamin D come in. So if you think of your bones as a bank, if you want to make sure there's enough in the bank so that you don't overdraw. So there's a few things you can do. You could put more in when you're younger, which you probably all should have done, but we're past that now, unfortunately, so you can't go back and do that. Having a higher peak bone mass, which is the bone mass at a younger age, gives you more to draw on later. The other thing you can do is you can keep making smaller deposits along the way so that you don't withdraw as quickly. So that's where calcium comes in. Calcium is the dominant mineral in bone. I think 99% of the calcium in your body is in your bone and your teeth, mostly in your bone. But you need calcium for everything. You need, your muscles need calcium to work, your nerves need, your heart, your brain need calcium. And the calcium in your blood is maintained in a very narrow but important range. And if the amount of calcium in your blood dips just slightly. That's sensed by these cells in your parathyroid gland. And what happens is it tells your body, calcium's getting low, we need to increase, we need more calcium. Two things can happen. One is that you can increase the absorption of calcium in your gut. And to do that, vitamin D is really important. To do that also, you have to have sufficient calcium and vitamin D intake. If you don't have sufficient calcium and vitamin D, the next place your body's gonna go looking at for calcium is your bones. So this is why, as we get older, there we don't absorb calcium as efficiently as we did when we were younger. The amount of calcium lost from the bones tends to increase, and that's why the rate of bone loss tends to exceed the rate of formation. So I've told you that calcium and vitamin D are important for your bones. So how much do you need? So these are the recommendations that the Institute of Medicine has. For calcium, the recommendation is 1,200 milligrams a day for women over 50. For men, it starts at 1,000, but at age 70, it goes up to 1,200. But you can see on the right, there's this column called the upper limit. So when it comes to nutrients, most nutrients, you need a certain amount, but more is not always better. And if you get too much, there is risk for adverse side effects. With calcium and vitamin D, the most documented one is things like kidney stones, which we all want to avoid. But this upper limit is not the number you should target. This is the number you should target, and generally you don't want to get more than this. Than 2,000 to 2,500 milligrams. For vitamin D, the recommendations for men and women are, depending on age, if you're under 70, 600 international units a day, and if you're over 70, 800. Again, but you generally don't want to exceed 4,000 international units a day. So where do we get calcium? Dairy foods are the most common and well-known sources. So you know, in this handout, I realized there was a typo on the slide. Yogurt, I think, was listed as 400. It's actually closer to 200 per serving. But these are the general, on average, amounts of calcium in certain foods. Calcium is one of those nutrients that is hard. Remember I said the recommendation is about 1,200 milligrams a day. It can be a challenge to get that much calcium just from your diet. So that's where supplements come in. Now, it's important, if you're not getting any calcium at all in your diet, a lot of supplements contain over 1,000 milligrams of calcium. In the situation of, for example, lactose intolerance or whatever, where you don't consume a lot of dairy foods, you might need that much. But the general idea is supplements will make up the difference that you don't get in your diet. It's generally best to get as much of the nutrients, not just calcium and vitamin D, but in general, get your nutrients from your diet, and then if you can't meet them through your diet, your dietary intake, that's where supplements are used to fill in the gap. The average calcium intake, I think, for older men, well, older women, it's generally around, I think, 700 milligrams. That's like a national average. So with the idea being that maybe a 500 milligram supplement would help. But again, that's the general. You can read labels, and I'll have a website at the end that shows you where you can look up calcium in your diet. So with vitamin D, it's similar. These are the sources of vitamin D. It's even harder to get the amount of vitamin D you need from your diet alone, because it's really not in a lot of foods we commonly consume. Fish is a good source, but not all fish. A lot of foods now are fortified, and it's a good idea to look at labels. The other source of vitamin D is the sun, but this is a little bit tricky. So
The way the sun works with the sunlight and vitamin D story is that you can make vitamin D on your skin when it's exposed to UV light. We are not as efficient as at doing that when we get older, but you can. However, in this part of the country, you can only do that maybe between May and September outside. If you were out in the sun and you exposed your hands, arms, and face, say, 10 to 15 minutes in June, like late morning, early afternoon, you'd probably achieve around 600 IUs. But if you wear sunscreen, which we're all told to do, wear sunscreen, you don't make vitamin D. So the recommendations for vitamin D don't include what you would make on your skin. Because for the most part, if we're wearing long sleeves and wearing sunscreen and hat and all that stuff, the amount that you make on your skin is minimal. I've said that calcium and vitamin D are both important because you need calcium to put in the bank for your bones, and you need vitamin D to help you absorb calcium. So one of the seminal studies that was done to really understand how important calcium and vitamin D on age-related bone loss was done at our center by Bess Dawson Hughes, who is an endocrinologist and probably one of the world's experts on nutrition, vitamin D, calcium, and bone. She was actually president of the International Osteoporosis Foundation at one point. So she conducted a 3-year study where it was men and women. There were about 400 enrolled, and half of them received a supplement that contained 700 milligrams of calcium and 400 international units of vitamin D. And the other group received a placebo. And for it was a 3-year study, so they took the pills for 3 years. And she measured bone mineral density, so I showed you the bone scan before and after. And what she found was that the men and women who received the calcium and the vitamin D had a slight increase in the bone mineral density of their hip, femoral neck. Sometimes I'll say femoral neck, I really think it's hip. Whereas there was a slight decrease in the placebo, but those groups, that was an important difference. Both groups had a slight increase in their bone mineral density of their lower spine, but actually the calcium and the vitamin D group had a higher increase or a greater increase. And when they looked at the total body's bone mineral density, there was a slight increase in the calcium and vitamin D supplemented, but there was actually a decrease. So there was more bone loss when they looked at the total body and the femoral neck and the placebo. So this was one of the first studies that really identified the importance of both nutrients together in reducing age-related bone loss. She also kept track of fractures, and so what she did, or the study team did, was they counted up the number of fractures in each group over the course of 3 years. So this top line is the number of fractures cumulative in the placebo group, and this is the number of cumulative fractures in the calcium plus vitamin D. So there were significantly fewer. This was any fracture at any site in the group that received the calcium and vitamin D. So now the question is, I told you that calcium and vitamin D are important, but you don't want to get too much because you might experience other side effects of having too high of an intake. So how do you know how much calcium and vitamin D you consume? So this is, we were having Giovanni over before, blueberry and strawberry. I don't imagine that there would be a difference in calcium, at least between the two flavors. But there's this handy-dandy database, and I'll have a website up again on my last slide, that's put together by the U.S. Department of Agriculture. And what you can do in a nutshell, you can basically look up the nutrient content of any food you want. Our center actually does some of the analysis, the
learning about vitamin K, you look up the vitamin K in this database, those foods were measured in our lab. For the sake of calcium or vitamin, I think I have a calcium example. The way it works is you can actually enter either a general name of a food, and I just typed in yogurt. So I went to the website, I typed in yogurt, and what happens is that this is not the only, the list went on and on and on and on. Any kind of yogurt, flavor, reduced fat, whole milk, whatever, it is listed here. There's over 21,000 foods that have been measured as part of this initiative by the USDA. So I just picked one. I think I picked Chobani blueberry. And you can see here, this is not an exhaustive list of nutrients, but the calcium comes up on relatively close to the top of the list. 200 milligrams of calcium in that serving of Chobani. So you can do this with any nutrient. I just did this by way of an example. So if you're interested in trying a kind of gauging how much calcium or vitamin D that you get in general, you can go to this website and start playing around and plugging in some foods and seeing. And that can also guide you in terms of supplements. You might not need like 1,200 milligrams of calcium in a supplement if you're getting a certain amount already in your diet. Anyway, so in conclusion, the study, adequate calcium and vitamin D are important for maintaining bone health in older adults. The evidence that calcium supplements increase the risk for heart disease or heart attack is weak. It got a lot of press, but the controversy seems to be less controversial now than it was. And this food composition database is a useful tool if you're interested in estimating calcium and vitamin D or actually any other nutrients. I think I have, I'll just leave these up if you are interested in writing them down. So these top two would be good resources for information on bones specifically, bone loss. They do have links to information about calcium and vitamin D in bone. And then again, this is the USDA